Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick again back here in United States. Praise God for the Lord's blessings. He is so good and so kind to his people. God is good to his people, brothers and sisters. He's always good. God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good. It's an easy song to learn. You know, Filipinos love that Don Moen songs because they're usually, you know, there's not a whole lot of words in it. It repeats the same thing. You can't say God is good too much. God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. That's the expression that they love to say over there in the Philippines because it's just so easy and so correct. God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. You can't beat God. You can't outdo God. You can't outgive God. You cannot love God. You can't outthink God. You can't outlive God. For God is eternal, everlasting, from everlasting to everlasting, the Bible says, from beginning to end. He's the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. Hallelujah. The first and the last. You can't be first and you can't be last because God's already got it all covered. He's got history laid out. It's already been finished in Christ. It's finished. He's the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by Jesus, Yeshua HaMashiach, the Son of the Most High God. El Elyon, the Most High God, hallelujah. Ben Elohim, Son of God, hallelujah. Glory to his name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, hallelujah. God Most High, Creator of heaven and earth, hallelujah, who gave his only begotten Son because he loved you and me and this world so much that whomsoever shall believe in him, the Lord Jesus Christ, shall not perish but have everlasting life, hallelujah. Hallelujah, glory to God. Hallelujah. What manner of love is this? That God would let us become his children through the blood of the only begotten Son of the Father, the one of a kind, Yeshua, HaMashiach. Hallelujah. The only begotten. You know, the King James says the only begotten, brothers and sisters. That's why lots of Muslims have problem because in the Quran, you know, when you walk into the El Aqsa Mosque up there on the Temple Mount and walk into all these mosques, they have the Arabic verse from the Quran up there. It says God is not begotten and God is not begot. Well, brothers and sisters, the text says that Jesus is the monogenes, is the Greek word. He's a monogenes, the one of a kind, the one and only. That's why in some of these other translations it'll say God's one and only unique Son, the one and only Son of God. He's not begotten in the way that humans begot, like the Mormons believe. The cult of Mormonism says that God has spiritual wives in heaven, multiple spiritual concubines, and he literally has sex with them, and then the little spirits come down and then indwell a woman, and God is literally, physically, the Father of all people. That's what the cult of Mormonism teaches. As a matter of fact, you know that girl that was kidnapped for years, and then they found her. She was living in the mountains with some guy who thought he was the Messiah, and they found her. You know, there in Utah, her dad, I saw him, he was on Oprah Winfrey way back. That's been since I've been in the ministry. It's been since the year 2000. And he was on there when she was still missing, pushing his Mormonism, saying that we're all the spiritual children of God, begotten of God. God is begotten people. That's not what the Bible says, brothers and sisters. That's the way it's written in the King James. The real word is monogenes. He is the one and only one of unique beginning, one of a kind, the only son of God, hallelujah. Praise God Almighty that he has given us his only, one and only Son. Hallelujah, that whomsoever would believe in Jesus Christ shall not perish but have everlasting life. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by Jesus. Who said that? Jesus said that. John 14:6. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes unto the Father except by me. Hallelujah. Praise Jesus. Brothers and sisters, you know there's people, you know, who think that the Old Testament is the greatest thing since peanut butter. They get obsessed with trying to follow the law and all these kind of things. When Jesus said in the Gospel of John, when he was talking to the Pharisees, he said, in the scriptures. Search the scriptures. You think you have eternal life, but you don't. Those scriptures speak about me. Those scriptures are pointing to me, the Messiah. That's what Jesus said. They didn't have eternal life in going to heaven. They were in the paradise, as Jesus tells us in the story of about the bosom of Abraham, the rich man and Lazarus. There's Sheol, which there was paradise and hell that were divided by a great gulf. Only after Jesus descended and led captivity captive. Jesus preached the gospel to the holy saints from the Old Testament, the Old Testament saints. He preached the gospel to them himself in Sheol, in paradise, in the bosom of Abraham. And he led captivity captive. He descended first and ascended on high and led captivity captive. And then the way to heaven was open, brothers and sisters, through the blood of Jesus. The Bible tells us in the Old Testament, no man can see the face of God and live. We cannot enter into his presence because of sin. That is why no one was going to heaven. That's why they built the tabernacle in the wilderness. That's why God told Moses, build the tabernacle in the wilderness after the pattern that I showed you in heaven. Just like King Solomon's temple later on was the same thing, but at a double size. They added more to it, and it was exactly twice the size as the tabernacle in the wilderness. That's a pattern of things to come. That's why only the high priest representing Christ could go into the Holy of Holies one day a year. On that Yom Kippur, the holy days, the holy day, he would go in there and sprinkle the blood on the ark for the sins of the people. Not to remove, but to cover the blood, the sins of the people. Then Jesus, of course, when he came, our sins are washed away, not covered, but removed. Jesus' blood is such a kind that it removes stains. Can you imagine if you're black, dirty, stained, like you've been in walking down through downtown Manila, and you're covered in black soot from pollution, you're wearing a white robe, and then you walk down the streets covered with black soot, with pollution, our sins, can you imagine that you would wash it in blood? Who ever heard of washing a white garment covered in black soot, like coal dust looking stuff, and wash it in blood, and it would come out white, white as snow, more whiter than it's ever been. Turned from filthy rags into a shining, white, perfect, pure, holy, innocent, righteous garment. Who ever heard of such a thing? As God said in his word, he uses the simple things of the world to confound the wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness to God, and then the wisdom of God is foolishness to them who are perishing, the Bible says. That's why, you know, the Lord was just talking to me last night. He was just talking to me last night about, you know, like, who, even Benny Hinn. And they had him on 2020 and all that. Listen to me, brothers and sisters. The devil wants to destroy. Don't believe everything you see on TV and hear about anybody that's a pastor or a, you know, and a Christian coming from the world. As Paul told us, why are you going to civil court? Don't you know that we'll be judging angels, and yet you take the simplest matter to the world and get your opinion from what they say on Dateline NBC or whatever? Now, I don't even sit around even thinking about Benny Hinn, but this is what the Lord prompted me last night, to tell you, to rebuke you, touch not my anointing and do my prophets no harm. Who are you to sit in judgment? All things will be brought to light by the Lord. Judge not before it's time. All things will be brought to light, and everyone will give an account and an answer to the Lord. Benny Hinn, Billy Graham, whomever, me, you, we all will. Why are you sitting in letting the world judge servants of God? These things ought not be, brothers and sisters. We let the Lord be the judge. God, let God be true and every man a liar. Let every tongue be still, as the Bible says, that we all stand and know that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. No, there's none righteous, no, not one. And that's the problem, brothers and sisters, as I'm switching topics here, of people dealing with ministries. Talk about Billy Graham, Benny Hinn, whoever you want to talk about, John Hagee. Every time I name a name of a preacher, there's people start hating and attacking the servant of God on my videos. There's some people that love John Hagee because he supports Israel. Other people hate John Hagee because he supports Israel. God didn't set you in judge over him. And guess what? John Hagee's fat. So what? Nobody's perfect. That's what I'm saying. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Obviously, John Hagee has a problem with eating. But that doesn't nullify and make the word of God of none effect that's coming out of his mouth. He obviously lacks, what's the fruit of the Spirit here? I guess it would probably be temperance, self-control when it comes to eating, as an example. Just as an example I'll throw out there. And who are you to judge another man's servant? As the Bible says, John Hagee is a servant of the Most High God, a man of God. Touch not my anointed, God says, and do my prophets no harm. And he who is without sin, cast the first stone. Now that's the biggest problem on YouTube that's in my spirit from the Lord, because little children, we are in the last hour. And we know that Antichrist will come. And here you are. I just want to say this. All those who are on YouTube who are making videos personally attacking people like John Hagee, whomever, who is a Christian, who confesses the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and is a minister of the gospel, even Benny Hinn, even though he wears a white suit and he flies in a jet and goes around the world, yeah, and he's also led more people to Jesus Christ than Billy Graham ever did. More people. He doesn't have it posted because his focus is healing, but millions and millions and millions of people have been born again under Benny Hinn's ministry. Just as an FYI, more than Billy Graham has ever led to the Lord. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I don't even want to say, you know, anything good, you know, attacking or really, I'm not promoting anybody or attacking anybody. The point is, brothers and sisters, that we, these false prophets, these fakers, these clowns who are not preachers on YouTube, go around calling people false prophets. A false prophet is Joseph Smith. Led millions and millions, or, you know, 100 million people were Mormons, led them away astray. The biggest false prophet on the earth, the biggest false prophet on the earth is the Pope, brothers and sisters. Now that's a false prophet who has another gospel, who just got through saying the other day, if you have a personal relationship, don't, you know, it's dangerous to try to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That's a false prophet. 2 billion people, or excuse me, 1.2 billion people in the world claim to be Roman Catholics. And the biggest cult, go look up the definition of cult. It has a leader who has a special revelation from God, who has infallible word from God. And if you don't agree with the leader, you're kicked out of the group. And several other points. You look up the Webster's Dictionary definition of a cult. Roman Catholicism is the biggest. So I'm trying to figure out why there are people who say they'd be Christians who are attacking Benny Hinn because they don't believe people should fall when you pray for him. Or they don't believe, they don't like his white suit. Or he flew on a private jet to go to Mumbai, India and preach to 10 million people in a week, evangelize them, millions of people get saved, millions of people get healed, and then you get one guy that went there as a skeptic who didn't get healed, who says Benny Hinn's a fake, and then people run with that, make videos about it. As an example, attacking a servant of God, even though I'm not out here a promoter or assistant of Benny Hinn, I'm a promoter of Jesus Christ and his gospel. Benny Hinn gives the gospel. Billy Graham gives the gospel. John Hagee gives the gospel. Then instead of attacking these servants of God, why don't you start making videos about the Jehovah Witnesses and the Mormons and the Pope and all of these real false prophets, these real cults, these real enemies of the cross. The people that I mentioned as an example, I repeat again, Benny Hinn, Billy Graham, John Hagee, whomever you want to talk about that's a born-again preacher. These are not enemies of the cross. These are servants of the cross. And none of them are perfect. I am not perfect. And you are definitely not perfect either. For he who has not sinned, cast the first stone. So that's why, brothers and sisters, we need to humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God. Touch not his anointing and do his prophets no harm. I warn you right now, you're going to give an account. Here's, you know, do you know, and that's why the devil's doing it. You don't even know, because I've heard people say, I don't sit around watching Benny Hinn. But I've heard him say, when I have seen him, I've heard him say how hurtful it is when people keep attacking him. Do you know that that's hindering his doing the ministry for the Lord? Let me just ask you this, oh, haters of the servants of God. How many people have you led to the Lord today? Like this, you know, the old chant, hey, hey, LBJ, how many boys did you kill today? So my question to you is, hey, hey, oh, fake YouTube, self-appointed, not a preacher. How many people did you send to hell today? How many people did you help stay lost today? If you are not called by God to get in the ministry, if you're not called by God to teach the word, even as a Sunday school teacher or whatever, you need to sit down. You need to shut up. You need to fold up and pack up and repent. Be quiet and humble yourselves before the mighty hand of God. Brothers and sisters, you know, I've never cared what anybody thinks about me. By the grace of God, the enemy tries to use, you know, people against all of us who are Christians. And it just seems to be the enemies are of our own household, brothers and sisters. And when I say household, I mean those who allege to be part of the body of Christ. Not necessarily your earthly household, but those who claim to be Christians. Those tares among the wheat, as Jesus already told us in the Gospels and prophesied and spoke that, you know, that the enemy came in the night, in the middle of the night, and sowed a bunch of weeds in amongst the wheat. And then the Lord said, you know, he's going to let them grow up together and sow the harvest time that it won't damage the wheat. And that's what we're dealing with, brothers and sisters. So I tell you, anyone that's on the internet making videos, personally attacking and running down and calling people false prophets who are not, who preach the gospel. Now, not everything they say, I agree. I don't agree with everything Perry Stone says. Perry Stone says he believes Antichrist is ahead of the imam, the 12th imam and all that stuff. I don't believe that's true. But it's a possibility, a slight possibility. I will say 99% I don't believe it's going to happen. Does that mean that Perry Stone's a false prophet? No. I just disagree with him about that doctrine. You know, no two, you know, hardly agree on anything. But we have to agree on John 3:16. Other than that, it's kind of open for interpretation, brothers and sisters. You know, there's different schools of thoughts on lots of different doctrines. Calvinism versus free will, you know, versus predestination. There's Bible verses to support those two positions and everything in between, brothers and sisters. The Lord didn't give us... God, by definition, is beyond our understanding. We don't understand all there is to know about God and every little detail of every little doctrine there is. It's not for us to know. It's not for ours to reason why, but to do or die. That's to get saved or go to hell. That's what it's for us to do. And then when we're saved, it's to be called to do the will of God. As Solomon, the greatest man of wisdom, said, it's all vanity. Vanity, vanity. Life is foolishness. Everything's repeat. There's nothing new under the sun. But the end of the matter is to please God, praise God, worship God, serve God, know God. The end of Ecclesiastes, that's what Solomon tells us. That's the end of all things. Is, do you know Jesus? Did you know Jesus? He says, the Lord's, when you die and leave this earth, brothers and sisters, if the rapture doesn't happen, which I believe it will, but let's just say, when you leave this earth, however way you leave this earth, you will see the Lord Jesus Christ. He will say one of two things to each of us, brothers and sisters, and friends. He will say, enter into your rest, my good and faithful servant, or depart from me, I never knew you. Depart from me, I never knew you, or enter into your rest, my good and faithful servant. So how do we enter heaven? By being a good and faithful servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's just that simple out of his own mouth, brothers and sisters. Not everyone who says to me, Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. But he who has done the will of my Father, which is in heaven. And that's what it is. And I'm telling you, the Lord didn't call you. The Lord didn't call you to call fellow Christians false prophets because you don't agree with them about the rapture one way or the other, because you don't agree with them about predestination or free will, contradiction of Calvinism and all that versus free will. God didn't call you to do that, brothers and sisters, to throw stones in the house of God. God didn't call you to do that. He calls people to proclaim the gospel, and really the job of overseers. The real word in the Greek, the real episcopal, the overseers, the elders of the church, the pastors, the preachers, they are called to deal with the wolf in sheep clothing. Not all the people in the church, but the elders of the church, the overseers, the preachers are called to call out those wolves in sheep's clothing. Now, a wolf in sheep's clothing, brother and sister, is, as the Apostle Paul tells us in Galatians, he gave us the interpretation for that. He said, if we, himself and the other apostles, if we are an angel from heaven, gives you a different gospel than the one we already gave you, let them be anathema, is the word, anathema. And then the English word is let them be accursed, let them be cursed to hell, if they give you a different gospel than the one we gave to you. So, brothers and sisters, that's the test of a false prophet or not. Do they give the gospel of Jesus Christ or another gospel? And so, as an example, Billy Graham gives the gospel of the Bible. Benny Hinn, though you may not agree with his white suit, and maybe you don't like him because you're prejudiced against people who have an Indian accent or whatever. Whatever is your major problem, and whatever is your major malfunction, as they say. Benny Hinn gives the gospel. He has an altar call at the beginning of every crusade he does. I've checked on him many times. Thousands of people come to the altar to get saved. He's been in Mumbai, India, these places in Africa. 2 million people come into one crusade. So my question to you is, when is the last time you had 2 million people come to listen to you? When is the last time You led people to the Lord to salvation by grace through faith. Are you saved? Not of your own, but a gift of God. Led people not by works. Tell them they got to do ABC and stand on their head and tie their shoes and go to church on Saturday. When have you given someone the gospel of Jesus Christ? By grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. When have you given John 14, 6, where Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Did you give him John 3, 16? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whomsoever shall believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. How about the most easiest one? Romans 10, 17. All who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. And Jesus also said that in John chapter 2, no one who comes to me will I cast out. I won't send away anybody that comes unto me. Jesus will give salvation to anybody that comes to him, calling upon his name, seeking his face, repenting, turning from their sins. Jesus, I'm a sinner. I'm lost and without hope in this world. As the Bible says, I've sinned in my life. I've done ABC. And I know that if I die today, I'll go to hell. I need to be saved. Jesus, Lord Jesus Christ, save me. I know you're the Messiah. I know you died on the cross. You took my place. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. The Bible tells us the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. But the wages of sin is death. God told Adam and Eve, when you eat the fruit of the tree, you're going to die. As a matter of fact, he said, the day you eat the fruit, you'll die. Guess what? 1,000 years with God is 1,000 years with man is with a day with God. No man lived to be over 1,000 years old. Adam was like 939 years old when he died. And no man, even Methuselah, lived to be 969. No man lived to be over 1,000 years, which is one day with God. Brother, sister, God kept his word as he promised. In the day you eat the fruit, you'll surely die. We all understand. We're all under the curse of sin from our parents, Adam and Eve. All have sinned and fallen short of his glory. All of us, including Benny Hinn, including Billy Graham. They'll never be perfect. Stop looking to preachers and saying, well, I saw Benny Hinn. He's stayed in some expensive hotel. He's living large. He's got an expensive watch. He's got an expensive ring. So therefore, he's a false prophet, and therefore, I got an excuse for why I'm full of sin. No. Don't judge God by what Billy Graham does. Don't judge God by what John Hagee does. These are only servants. Like me, I'm only a servant. You don't base your relationship with God or anything by what I say or do. I'm only a man. I'm subject to all the faults of the world just like anybody else. That's the biggest problem in the body of Christ. The people that I deal with, they exalt preachers up high, that they're supposed to be. And then when they see a preacher that made a mistake, then suddenly they're crushed. It just damages their relationship with God. No way, because the Bible says we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Don't put your faith, hope, and trust in any man. Put your faith, hope, and trust in God. That's why lots of people are making these videos, because they have some kind of thing like, oh, this Benny Hinn's supposed to be just like Jesus. No, everybody's supposed to be like Jesus. But nobody is going to be there, and we'll never be perfect until we enter into the kingdom of heaven, and we get our glorified bodies, and we're seated there with the Lord, literally in heaven, after we're there, at the end of the age, then death will be swallowed up in victory. Then grave, there will be no sting. Then there'll be no more sin. The Lord will wipe away our tears. We'll be totally, literally, 100% free. We're in the process of being set free. We're in the process of being saved. Those who are being saved, we're being saved. We're being set free. We're getting out of here. But we're not yet, brothers and sisters. Our spirit has been, the Bible says God put an earnest on us, a deposit, like when you go to buy a house. You make a contract to buy the house and you put down an earnest. Just like when a man tries to betroth a woman, he gives her a ring. It's like when Joseph went and betrothed himself to Mary. They got engaged. They were all set up. He gave something to, in those days he brought a dowry or whatever and gave it to her parents. And, he sealed the deal, but she was still not his wife yet. She was betrothed to him, but she wasn't with him yet. So the same thing with us, brothers and sisters. We've been betrothed to the Lord. He's made an earnest on us, a deposit, a down payment, the Holy Spirit, to seal us, to comfort us, to carry us through this life, brothers and sisters. And then we will be saved. We're not saved, fully saved yet. We're being saved, the Bible says. And like in Hebrews, and all the Greek words of saved, it's actually a present tense thing. It's being saved. Just like Jesus said, I am. And God told Moses, I am. He didn't say I was or I'm going to be. I am. It's in this moment, in this time, and where you're standing right now, God is. He is the great I am. I am right now. He's in the now. Your salvation is in the now. It's a verb. It's happening right now, a present tense verb. as it says in Hebrews, you know, the angels, those ministering spirits, are assigned to those of us who are being saved. And as I said in the original Greek, almost all the times when you see the saved thing, the real thing is those who are being saved. Being saved. We're being saved. It's a process. We're still on this earth. We haven't been redeemed off this earth yet. We don't have our glorified bodies. We're going to still die unless the Lord returns. We still get sick. We're still in our bodies, brothers and sisters. Now, there's times by our faith that we get answered prayer, what we call, a.k.a., a miracle, where God overrides the system that we're in, and He blesses you. He blesses you financially. He heals you. He does all those things and overrides. Those are miracles. That's, you know, it's a miracle. When He overrides the system that He set up and He reaches down into the present time, somebody gets saved. Getting saved is a miracle. Getting healed is a miracle. Getting that answered prayer is a miracle. When God reaches through time and answers us today and gives us today a taste of what will be like in heaven, like speaking in tongues, the gifts of the Spirit, gift of healing, gift of prophecy, all those things. A taste of the heavenly calling and heavenly gift. Brothers and sisters, I've been going for a while. I'm cut it off. I already changed lots of topics the way I always do. You know me, brothers and sisters. You know I love you guys, and I stand firm. And like I say, I guess people know by now, or, you know, I had to block them or whatever. But, hey, I don't take, you know, I'm not overly dogmatic in doctrines. You know, I'm not going to sit here and say I know everything and everybody else is wrong. But I don't take no junk off of people who try to, you know, put, you know, get in that political correctness and all that stuff. I don't take no political correctness. I'm going to say what the Lord leads me to say, and I don't care. I really don't, because I'm preaching for a one-man audience, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's how you need to live your life, brothers and sisters. You are performing for a one-person audience, the Lord Jesus Christ. You're not performing for men. Don't be man-pleaser. Don't be a people-pleaser. Please the Lord. And in the process of pleasing the Lord, of course, the Lord tells us to love, you know, love Him with all of our heart, all our mind, all our soul, and all of our body, and love our neighbor as ourselves. So, of course, in the process of loving your neighbors is not because, oh, you want your neighbor to like you, but because the Lord commanded us to. It's like water baptism. I have people every day tell me, well, what if I don't have time to get water baptized? Well, the Lord commanded us to get water baptized. You need to figure out a way to get water baptized because the Lord commanded us to. Not that we need to be water baptized to be saved, but the Lord commanded us to be baptized. We need to be baptized. As the Lord will make a way, I'll baptize you. You need to get baptized in water. That's what the Lord commanded us to do. Out of an act of obedience. That's what it's all about. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. If you love the Lord, you will obey him as much as you can, brothers and sisters. And then when we sin, the Bible says, we have an advocate with the Father. From 1 John, it says, if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. And verse 7, John chapter 1, verse 7, and John chapter 1, verse 9, it says, and if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. That's for us, the church, brothers and sisters. He's writing to the church. Talking about the lost right there. We Christians need to repent, and he will forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. God bless you guys.